I can tell you what's in store for everyone. I think I'm living in a haunted town. I think the country is turning evil. Today is July 30th. Of course, I was in horrendous pain all night from them torturing my back after they sent me a picture yesterday of the sciatic nerve being tortured. Well, they went up and down my whole spine. It wasn't just the sciatic nerve region. If you touch my back, it was hot when I woke up. I had trouble walking. And each time they do this, I feel like there's more areas that are being disintegrated. And about 5 years ago, when they tore my back, I went to the hospital. They said my back had been torn. They found it on MRI. But they said I had a hard life of heavy labor because my back was in such bad shape. I looked at the films, and my husband did too. That was not from heavy labor. It was from night after night of being attacked with these military weapons. What the devil has done is created weapons so that when they attack you with them, not only can you not see them, it makes people look like the kind of injuries that they get are like from natural age progression. These people that use these weapons are so satanic. I think I'm an experiment. I think the things they do are unholy, like when they invade my soul and when they hack my brain. But today, they were attacking me when I tried to exercise. And it's not my heart. I went to the hospital. I went to my family doctor. My family doctor saw me right after one of the attacks when I still couldn't inhale. And he said, Sherry, I don't know why you can't take a deep breath. Maybe you have pleurisy. Because he said, you clearly cannot breathe. Because he listened to me with the stethoscope. So he did a chest x-ray. He goes, you have all the symptoms of this, but it doesn't show up on film, so I'm going to treat you with antibiotics. Well, I went to the hospital with it. The doctor said, well, you're definitely not breathing right. Let me do some heart tests. Let me check your blood to see if you're having a heart attack. He goes, with your symptoms, you might have had one. Well, I hadn't had a heart attack. Then he says, well, with the symptoms I see you having, I'm checking you for blood clots. You might have one in your lungs because I don't know what would be producing any symptoms. No blood clots in lungs. Somebody followed me to the hospital. And after I was at the hospital within half an hour, my symptoms went completely away. Completely. And then the people started telling me on the internet, if you don't do what we say, we can attack your heart again. I'd be damned if they didn't do it. And they would tell me before they attacked my heart. This is all being done with weapons. And so today, I got in my pool to exercise because it hurts too bad to get on the treadmill. I'm in too much pain from what they did last night. They do not want me losing weight because they told me before I got heavy, they wanted to make me fat. Then they said they wanted to make me ugly. They're this evil. They want me to just slowly feel every part of me disintegrate. And then they say, well, you've got a pretty face, but you're a homophobe, so we want to get rid of your face. And then they start taking pictures of me on my cell phone and making me have a beard and making me a man. And then they attack me because they say I'm Christian. Well, today they were attacking my heart and I swelled up. My face was real big and swollen because my body, like today when I did a film, when I had the white dress on, they had attacked my heart to where I couldn't feel the bottom of my feet. And then my feet felt like they were 2 inches thick because they had made my body so swollen that my feet were like flippers. I would put them on the ground, but I couldn't feel the bottom, and I was having trouble walking, and then I'm staggering back and forth. And I've talked to other people on the internet that are being abused, and they've lately told me they're staggering by what they're doing to their brain. I just want to tell you what you're in store for here in this country. When this first started happening to me, after someone, a family relative on my husband's side, wanted to come to the house, the only time they ever wanted to come to the house. Her and her brother both went to visit us, and they'd never been to this house, not even once. And I hadn't seen them in 10 years. And then I noticed right after that, all my computer monitors were leading the images toward the front window to the side. Well, then we both started burning every night. And then I got a trifield meter, and I put it on my skin in the areas they were attacking, which is the ovaries, my stomach, and my thyroid region. And then my thyroid stopped working. I stopped having periods and haven't had any since, except for maybe once. They stopped my periods with the weapons, damaged my thyroid, and then I started having a damaged liver. Now they're telling me, go check your body. We've given you cancer. they told me when they first started doing it, they told me on the internet, we're going to do this to your brain so much that eventually we'll give you brain cancer. My husband eventually got something. And now they're just telling me they're putting demons in my house. How evil can you really be? This has nothing to do with being gay, because I went to gay people's classes. There's a whole conference, and the classes, the writers I like the most just happen to be gay. I never had anything against gay people. If I had anything against gay people, why would I buy an expensive conference ticket and go learn from someone who was my favorite author who happened to be gay? I didn't care about people's sexual preference. You know, I'm the kind of girl that was taught by a nun that said sex is for is not procreation, it's for conception and for love. So, I mean, that was my philosophy. And when I was a teenager, a person took me to parties with models and tried to get me in that sleazy business. And first party I went to, this model wrapped her legs around this guy she didn't even know. And they were all kind of getting kind of kinky with their clothes on, and they were trying to seduce the young girls in the room, and that was the only party I went to, because I got a real taste of how promiscuous people are in the entertainment industry, and I realized it wasn't for me. And I went out with a guy who came into my business when I was working, and I was going to college too, but I was working in a department store, and he came in, and he used to hang out, and he was a kickboxer. And I didn't like boxing, but he said, will you go watch me fight? So I went and watched him fight. And then at the Little Apple, which was the popular kickboxing place that sometimes was televised, the owner asked me if I would be ring girl. Well, I thought, well, it's a new experience. And then this place called New York West asked me if I would model. So I wore a leotard, and I went the first night. And I was a nervous wreck. I was scared to death. It was the first time I'd been in modeled for an assignment that and I'd had to wear a leotard. That made it even more frightening. And I was one of the few women in the room. But they liked me, so they wanted me to come back for the televised event. And I took my mom, and we she sat in the front row. And then all these reporters and news people that came for the event kept asking who I was. And so the editor of the Courier Journal asked if I would go out with him. He lived in Indiana. And so I did. And I remember he took me to a party. And it was so embarrassing, because all night long he kept going around telling all these wealthy people, can you believe she's a virgin? Can you believe she's a virgin? And I was like, I wanted to hide under the table. And then one of the people that owned the radio station, I remember they went upstairs and they did heroin. And then I remember he started telling me all these big wigs that owned businesses and that were very wealthy were there just to do drugs. And, you know, I knew at a young age I did not want that at all. But I remember he got so wasted. He told me he could not drive me back to my car. It was in Indiana and I had parked at White Castle. And so I parked at White Castle, and because I didn't know how to get to his house, it was like off in the hills somewhere. So we drove to his house. Well, he was so wasted, he said, I'm sorry, but I can't take you back to your car. So he took me back to his house, and then he built a fire, and he tried to get me to lay on the floor with him. Well, I was petrified. So instead of sleeping, because I didn't really know this man, I stayed awake all night long. Well, the next day I had to be at Stewart's. I had to be at work, and I was in college too. So I drove across the bridge, and I came back to Louisville, and it was like a 45-minute drive. And I remembered it started to rain, and I hadn't had anything to eat that day, and I do have hyperglycemia. And I remember I was at the end of Churchill Downs, where I used to work all the time. I used to catch the bus there. It was just a popular place for me. And then I remember I went to take off from the light, and all I saw was this big car coming at me. Oh my God, it looked like it was doing 100 miles an hour. I knew there was no way in heck I could brake. And the light had just turned green, and this guy was trying to run the red light. All I remember is I was knocked unconscious, and he hit me on the left, and he knocked me into the telephone pole straight on, and I took pieces of wood out of the telephone pole, and then I didn't have a seatbelt on, so it flung me forward and busted the windshield with my head, threw me on the passenger side. So then when I got to the hospital, I was so brain damaged, I didn't know my name. I didn't know where I was. I knew my mom. I lost my grammar skills. I couldn't even remember what happened. I had no idea what happened. But I remember that my mom said, "Oh my God, I'm so grateful. I saw you before I saw your car." And then I remember I would just cry and look at the doctors and everything and wonder why I didn't know who I was, why I didn't know my name, if I'd ever get my mind back, if, you know, I ever get my memory. And I remember I would pray to God. I knew who God was, you know. I talked to God, and I talked to my mom, and eventually things came back to me over time, but I never really got all my grammar skills back. So I dropped college. I was feature editor in my newspaper. I dropped college, and so you can see how, why I don't like a lot of, I don't want to be working with people in the film industry other than being a writer. You can see how I never liked that party scene from the beginning. You can see how people like that always made me uncomfortable. The whole atmosphere. I never got drunk. I was never a party girl. And for these people to be attacking me now and telling me they want me to have sex with these strange men, it's just a nightmare for me. It's terrible because I had a very traumatic experience because I went to a party with someone. And it after I had that brain injury, the people that knew me, like the guy who I'd gone to this party with, he came to the hospital and brought me flowers. And he said he didn't recognize me. I looked like the elephant woman. Because he said, "You were so pretty before your accident. Now your face is so deformed." And I swelled after that accident. And the swelling never went down. I went to all these specialists. I went to James Gardner's doctor. I went to Jeffrey Okinson, which is a celebrity doctor. I went to Dr. Clear. I went to Dr. Alpert. I went to the very best. They said that my jaw was so deformed on one side because it was never developed because I was early. The other side had deteriorated, but they did not know what in the world caused me to swell up like a blowfish. And they couldn't understand. And all the specialists said they'd never seen anything like it. Well, finally, one doctor said I had autonomic nervous disorder, which he said, my body is always overreacting and it thinks like, it's like a sprinkler system goes off thinking there's a fire, but there's no fire. So my body is firing off. But whatever damaged me in the wreck was never repaired. And to be attacked all the time now with these weapons, after I was diagnosed at Mayo as having a sleeping disorder that's in the brain that I can't be sedated for because I stopped breathing, and after they told me from my first test I stopped breathing over 200 times in one night, to be assaulted by these weapons every night by people that are famous is just unbelievable. You know, they treat me like I'm the devil. And then tonight they're telling me the most outlandish stuff. They say I'm a descendant of someone who accused the witches in the witch trial of being a witch. Where do the hell did they come up with this stuff? They talk to me about reincarnation. I don't think I'm a reincarnated. I have a powerful imagination. But do you see how much trouble my imagination got me into? My imagination is what got all these evil people after me.